Hello, Professor Peter, and we appreciate that you find an hour to speak with us on the framework on the project City as a Classroom. May I ask you, Professor Peter, one of your main aspects of your research of cities is a symbolic side of urbanism. Could we please speak about it? Why did you start studying symbolism, which is a very complex topic?
I am an anthropologist. And anthropologists do a lot of work on symbolism and rituals, often in non-Western societies, in traditional societies. And they almost never study cities. And geographers, they do a lot of work in cities, but they never study symbolism and rituals. So in the 1990s, I thought, well, I can make the combination. I was an urban anthropologist and I was studying poverty, types of cities, all sorts of things, but I didn't study yet symbolism. But in the 1990s, I thought I have to study urban symbolism because even in a million city, there's also a lot of symbols and rituals. And my first publication was in 1993, and it's called Urban Symbolism. And I started with making a study on the symbolism of Jakarta, because in the 1970s I had been living there for some time. And I discovered that there are a lot of monuments and architecture with symbolic meanings from the colonial times, from the Sukarno period, from the Suharto period, and that this were layered of symbolism in the city. And I described them, and then I tried to make, and also, of course, statues. But a lot of colonial statues were disrupted. A lot of street names of the Dutch time were changed into Bahasa Indonesia. And so there was a lot of dynamics in this symbolism, and it has a strong historic background. And you can read history in it. So then I tried to make it a theory, and the theory had several points. One was that every city has a symbolic structure, even smaller cities, but the bearers of symbols can be totally different. Sometimes it's statues, sometimes it's narratives, sometimes it's street names, it's the meaning you give to things, sometimes it's festivities, meanings you give to areas, etc., etc. So there are always symbols in cities. They also have a hierarchy. Some symbols are more important and some symbols are less important. So there's a hierarchy of symbols and there are a lot of elements. So you have different statues which make up the total configuration. And there is dynamics because they change and they are different for one group than for other groups, and they can even be contested. In Jakarta, they did it by making jokes of it because it's a very top-down, it can be top-down and bottom-up, and the symbolism in Jakarta is very top-down by those different governments. And of course, it's very heavy symbolism, because in the Sukarno area, he used statues from communist type, which are completely different than the Indonesian style. So a lot of Indonesians make all sorts of jokes of it. So you can also contest it by joking it. You can contest it by changing it. You can contest it by throwing it away. So you have a lot of statues of communist origin in Russia and in Eastern Europe, which are thrown away Now, at the moment, they are throwing away statues in England and in Russia, which have a race connotation, a slavery connotation. So symbols, my conclusion was, symbols are very important. People know them, but often they don't know the whole picture of a city. And that's where comes the anthropologist, because the anthropologist can study the whole pattern and then remark the whole history of symbolism in a city, and also how it's contested by different groups, how different groups look at it, sometimes not contested, but still giving it a different meaning, because a symbol is something standing for something else. A symbol is not a sign. A sign is, for example, WC, and there you go if you want to go to the WC. It doesn't stand for anything else. But the symbol always stands for something else. And that is the way it can also change, because you can give it a different meaning. So the whole picture is about meaning. What meaning do people give to the environment? How do they try to dominate the environment, the urban environment? How do they try, by dominating the urban environment, to dominate other people or to contest that? And when I had written my first article on that, which was in this book, Urban Symbolism, in 1993, of course, I cannot do the cities in the whole world. So I asked other students, I asked students which are doing anthropology in the Netherlands in my university, and they have to do their practice, their field work, everywhere they can do it in the world for 3 months. So I invited some of them to go to a city and then first to be acquainted with the city, so that you know where everything is, what types of groups there are, what are the main institutions, so that you can find your way. And then do interviews with persons and start the interview with a mental map of a narrative map. A mental map is asking them, please, could you make a map of the city? And then they do that, and then you ask, why do you write this? Why do you write that? What is this? So you use it as a means of communication about the environment and what they think is important. And then when you have, for example, 20 maps, you compare them and you can lay them one over another. And then you can see what are the main things they mention. Sometimes only one person mentions something, his own house. Well, that's not so important. But if everybody mentions the same thing, then that's a very important thing. And then you have to ask, what does that mean? Why is that important for you? And then you have to go there. As an anthropologist, you go there and you do your observation. What do you see there? And write down what did it mean. And of course, you have to know the history of the city. So you have to make a study of the city first, and then to make yourself acquainted with the city, and then to do this mental map, and then discuss over the mental map, and then write that down. And then you will see that all the persons in the city only see a part of the city, only see part of the symbolism. Because in Jakarta, for example, or in Buenos Aires or Beijing, nobody knows the whole city, because they go from their house to their work and back. And sometimes they go to a restaurant or something, but nobody is exploring the city as a whole. And then, as an anthropologist, you are going to do that. And you put together all those interviews, and then you get a complete picture of the whole city. And if you have that, you discuss it with them. You discuss it, for example, with classes of students, and you say, well, I made a study of Jakarta, I found this and this and this, what do you think of it? And then they are very amazed. And they say, well, I've never seen it like that. Because there, I never come there. And there, I never come there. They only see part of such a big city. So that was my first start. And in the book Urban Symbolism, a number of cities are taken, and I try to develop new concepts. And later on, I made the book Hypercity, and that was a little bit broader, because I thought, well, it's not only how the city and this, or how the symbols are distributed in the city, but it is in fact the whole upper part, you could say, the symbolic part, the ritual part of the city, and also, for example, festivities. And then here in Leiden, where I live, there is one festivity in which is on the 3rd of October. And I wrote an article on that, because that is the, then they became free from the Spaniards in four centuries ago. So you see that sometimes it's statues, but statues in Leiden, they are there, but they are not that important. They are often very small, and they are linked to family matters. A mother with child, a strange child, this type of things. But, and of course, in 1944, the end of the war. But the main thing in Leiden is this festivity of one day. All the Leideners are saving money the whole year to put all their money at the festivities. And the church plays a role in it, the city plays a role in it, the university plays a role in it. But it is a reversed ritual. That means that the people are the bosses, and the bosses are under the people for one day. So it's a reversal of society during the ritual. So then I also asked some students to look, oh no, I made an article myself on a birth myth of cities in Indonesia, Banyuwangi, Yogyakarta, and so on. And then I asked a few students to look into poems on Jakarta, and they made an article on that. But not in Jakarta, yeah, they made it in Jakarta. But others did Yogyakarta, others did Mexico City, Buenos Aires, the towers of 9/11 in New York, and how the monument was recreated after being destroyed by Al-Qaeda, how it was recreated and what different types of proposals were there, and then now it's new. I don't know if you have been there, but if you have been there, it's a very beautiful monument. So these were all types of studies that were made by students under my guidance, of course. But first they read my book, and then they said, okay, I can do that also. And then I said, well, go to the city, make your acquaintance, and look, what is the main... Then they said to me, what do I have to study? And then I said, well, I don't know, because I don't know what are the symbolic barriers of that city. It can be street names, it can be statues, it can be stories, it can be rituals. You have to look there. So after this urban symbolism, which I showed you, I did this hypercity, mm-hmm. which was in... 2006. Mm-hmm. And then I did this Cities Full of Symbols.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that you have seen?
Yes.
And at the end, I also tried to make a proposal for a paradigm, mm-hmm. how to study urban symbolism in cities. Yes. And what are the main questions?
I'm really interested to ask about this book, because in this book you wrote that there are four types of symbols.
Yeah.
You said that it's material, discursive, iconic, and behavioral. Could you please elaborate on each and explain how they influence people?
Often it's top-down.
Top-down?
Because people, it is a government who has to say that a statue can be there. You are not free to put all statues that you want yourself. Sometimes people can ask the government, we want here a statue. So there is also a little bit of bottom-up. But often it's to legitimize the government. But then, if it's too heavy, you can make jokes on it. Mm-hmm. So that you can neutralize it. And that's what they did in Jakarta.
Can you show examples maybe? Yeah, also, of material symbols.
Yeah, architecture is also very important, of course, but it depends on the city. And the layout of the city is also very important. For example, New York has a grid pattern. Some Indonesian cities have a grid pattern. And that makes sometimes the city more pretty. So the prettiness of a city is also linked to urban symbolism. If you have a clear city, there's a clear symbolic structure, it's more easy to live there. Because then you have landmarks. You know where to go. It's very easy in Jakarta. If I say, well, you have to go to the center, okay, you have to go to Monas. Everybody knows. And you can make an appointment there. So this urban symbolism of cities is also important for how people see the city and are delighted by the city or not. Then you have discursive, mm-hmm. for example, myths, poems, mm-hmm. Stories in the newspapers about the city. And then, of course, you have often how the city presents itself on the internet. So that's also very important nowadays, not earlier, of course, but after the 1990s, now at the moment, cities present themselves on the internet as attractive, and now even they try to become less attractive, because they are so attractive as Amsterdam, Venice, they become too attractive for tourists, so they want to be less attractive. Behavioral, that's also that are festivities or this type of things. And what was the fourth one? Which was it? Discursive, behavioral, material,
discursive, iconic, and behavioral.
I don't know what iconic was.
Yeah. It was maybe something also not like sculpture, but something that symbols, like example, maybe, I think maybe it's about it, that I saw one picture, photograph.
Oh, I know yeah. already. For example, you have religious places.
Yes.
And then Maria in Kevelaar here in Germany, that is a small place where pilgrims go to. Mm-hmm. And that is an iconic city. So in fact, this small thing of Maria, everybody goes there. And that's what you call an iconic city. And I have made some study of of Kevelaar. And of course, New York is also a pilgrimage place for 9/11. So those four are important. I think the material is perhaps more important for tourism, mm-hmm. and how you present your city. Iconic also, because that is the icon that is most important. And when how it's written, yeah, it's also important because, yeah, you see it on internet, and it's often they give you stories about the how the city mm-hmm. came into existence or this type of thing. So I think all four are important, but not everything is as important for all cities. It differs per city. And in one city, one thing is important, and another city, another thing is important. But often, everything is there. But we also find cities in Africa, I don't remember which one, where we didn't find any symbols. So, and they even had no street names. So that was, but people knew areas and give meaning to certain areas, but still there was something, but it can be rudimentary and it can be very expressive and very, and it can be in transition. So sometimes you have two images of cities which are conquering. When the city is changing from, for example, an industrial town to a tourist town. And then the industrial monuments are decaying and they want more art in it. And then you see symbolism can be very clear pattern, but it can also be in change, in transformation, and it can be very minimal.
You said that symbols have an hierarchy. Maybe you know this hierarchy, levels, and with difference, how you understand that this is a symbol from, like example, high level of hierarchy, and this is the less level, like your view.
Yeah. When you do those interviews, then it becomes very clear. Because if you do 20 interviews, and one monument is only mentioned by two persons, then it is most probably by lower level. And one symbol which is mentioned by everybody, that is of the highest level. So, of course, you have yourself to make a decision what level is what symbol. And perhaps it's not so clear sometimes.
How many levels you find?
You can make two levels or three levels, whatever you want. It depends on the city also.
Thank you so much. Also, may I continue to speak about symbols because it's a really interesting topic. So you did extensive research in urban anthropology and sociology in the context of Indonesia. Maybe you have considered comparing Indonesia architecture to other countries, like example, Europe, and different symbols of it.
Yeah, of course, they are very different. If you go to Bali, you have a lot of small rituals, people giving things to the gods. And of course you have a very clear pattern because you have the holy mountain to the sea, there's a city in between. So this is the direction of the gods to the north. If you are in Denpasar, if you are north of the hill, the mountain, it's the reverse. But if you are in Denpasar, then the north to the holy mountain is important. And so the whole arrangement of the city is made up by the directions from the sea to the mountain. Of course, you don't have that in Holland. We don't have such a directions in religious but still, we have often a marketplace. This is church and town hall and this type of things. And that you have in Indonesia also. You have the Alun-Alun and then you have the mosque in the west, in the west, and you have the government house and so and the prison at the local place. So in and sometimes you have, of course, new towns, such as Canberra, and you have Washington. So they were perceived from the standpoint of symbolism. If you go to Washington, of course, you have the White House and the pillar and the water. So this is all one pattern to give status, symbolic status to the country and to the capital. In Canberra, you have the same. In Australia, that is. So, it is very different. If you look at the book Cities of Symbols, you see the different architecture mm-hmm. by the different cities.
Yes, true.
So very this different. Is Jakarta.
Mm-hmm.
This is a monument of Suharto. And of course, Suharto has gone. He has died also. And now, after Suharto, it was democratic. And this monument, here you see people, now it's empty. Nobody comes there anymore, and they say it's false. It is a false monument. And let's see, what do we have here? Yeah, these are typically houses in Amsterdam. And this is, of course, the symbol of America.
Yes.
So, yeah, you have to look, when you study a city, if people think that architecture is important or not. So you cannot say it in general.
Professor
the
Peter,
symbols per city can be very different.
In this book, Cities Full of Symbols, there is a photograph of a cathedral in Netherlands with a ship inside of the church. The same tendency we also can see not only in the Netherlands, like example in Germany, in other countries of Europe. How do you think, what is the meaning of the ship in the church as a symbol? What it can be?
This I don't know what it is in other countries, of course, but this was in Haarlem. This is a city in the Netherlands, and the people in Haarlem were also invested in sailing ships, and they got their money from it. Of course, they put money in and they got money out, and so they were also religious. So they made a combination of religion and shipping, and this is what is combined there. I don't remember fully at the moment how Haarlem and Leiden both also fought to the Spaniards. And Leiden has this big ritual of the 3rd of October, but Haarlem doesn't have that.
Mm-hmm.
So they have taken another element of later times, I think, because that was, although in that time they already were shipfarers. I don't know exactly.
Now we can also to speak about historical times. Like example, if you look on the symbols from historical side, in different historical periods, there was different symbols. In your opinion, what makes modern symbols different than, let's say, symbols what was 200 years ago?
If you go to Roman cities, you have the Agora, which is the center, which was very important for them, and you have the temples. So it depends on the religion, of course. In the Catholic in Catholic Europe, in the Middle Ages, of course, the churches were the most important, the cathedrals. So you had those big cathedrals, and they were built over centuries. They took centuries to be built. So there a lot of money was put into. But also the castles, of course, because you had the castles of the nobility, which were also symbols of the power, of the power structure. But then, of course, later, when the cities were growing, first the cities were bishop cities in the Middle Ages, in Europe. But after the Middle Ages, Ghent and Brugge and became more important. They had cloth from wool from England, went to the Flemish cities, and those Flemish cities became rich, mm-hmm. and the nobility became dependent of their money, of the money of the citizens. And then the citizens became free. So they said, okay, you can get money from me, but within the walls of the city, we are free. And so the cities could make their own symbolism. So the symbolism of the nobility, of course, were the castles and the things in the rural areas. And the citizens, they made their own. And from that, in Europe, you can see how it's gone. But that's different from Indonesia. But because in Indonesia, the first symbols were, of course, Dutch symbols of colonialism. Although before that, of course, you had Indonesian symbols and Indonesian cities, as Yogyakarta, with their own symbolism. And then, of course, after the colonial period, in Indonesia, all the symbols from the Dutch were destroyed. So all the street names were changed, all the statues from Dutch people who were important were thrown away, and Sukarno made his new statues to, what he did is, of what his problems was, he had a new town, which should be an Indonesian town, but it looked like a Dutch town. And of course he didn't like that, because he didn't want to live in a Dutch town. So what could he do? He could make a new town. That they have done in Brasilia. There they have changed place and made a complete new town, because they wanted to get rid of the colonial past with the towns directed towards Spain. And so they made a town in the middle of the Amazon of Brazil. But he didn't make a new town, Sukarno, but he thought, well, I changed the symbolism. And he kept the town, and he changed the symbolism by making very big statues. And by changing all the names of the city, of the streets. So, and then Jakarta got its own new identity. So he didn't make a new town, but he changed the symbolic structure of the town. And he was also an artist, he was an architect. So he knew how important that is. That's why he did it like that. But others, also in some African countries and in some other Asian countries, Malaysia, they make the choice to make a new town, a new capital.
Understand. So may I ask last question for today? If we can see the modern symbols, if we can see the modern symbols, like example, who is start to build on this year's 20th century, and compare with the symbols of 17th century, 18th century, in your opinion, which ones are more influential on person, on people who look on it, who walk through the symbols?
I cannot say that. You have to ask the people themselves. So the importance of a symbol in a city, for example, here in Leiden, mm-hmm. the 3rd of October festivity is important for everybody. All Leidens know it. all Londoners take part in it, almost all, and if they can. So this is a very strong symbol. And if you talk with Londoners, they will tell you that. That is very easy to find out. And of course, there are people from Morocco, from Turkey, and then you have to ask them, what do you think of that? Do you take part in that? Or is it strange for you? And don't you want to take part in it? And so it is possible that some groups are excluded or exclude themselves because nobody says they are not allowed to join, but they just don't do. But some do, especially when it's when it's festivities, some go there and have a look, even if they are from another country. And their children perhaps do it more. So that changes over the... So, for example, some symbols, for example, in Amsterdam, you have the central place for the palace, in front of the palace. Well, that's a symbol of freedom of 1944. And that's important for the whole country. So some symbols have a national or even an international strength. For example, this this statue here. This statue is international in America. So this is so strong. This is for the whole world. Everybody knows it. And in the Eiffel Tower, everybody knows it in the whole world. So you have those symbols which are worldwide importance. And then you have national symbols, and then you have local symbols. And the local symbols are also important for the people living there.
Thank you so much.